Hey, it's John at Enduring Charm. You know, it's a cold and dreary day today, but I want to be out here to show you some wood clapboard that I personally put up probably about 20, or actually more than 20 years ago. And it's still in excellent shape. And I know for a fact this has only been painted once. Now, a lot of people, when they try to re-side a house in the modern era here, they might go for vinyl or a cement board product. But I'm telling you, wood can be put up and painted, and it will last if it's done right. And in this video, I'm going to show you all the tips and tricks you need in order for wood clapboard to be put up and to last, just like this has. Now, if we look at a close-up of the siding here, this is a seam between one board and the other board, that vertical seam right there. Notice how tight that is. Notice that there's no gaps underneath the boards. And if you notice, the paint is not peeling, it's not bubbling, it's all in excellent shape. I also want to make clear that I'm talking about entire walls or entire houses in this video. Sometimes you're doing repairs or patches to siding for various reasons, and that's also kind of a separate issue. Many of the things I'm going to be talking about also apply in that case, but mainly I'm talking about doing an entire house or an entire wall in this video. All right, back in the shop here where it's a little bit warmer, I have some scrap pieces of cedar half-inch beveled siding, okay? So this is very common. In fact, it's probably the most common cedar siding that you find. Sometimes you see this in redwood as well. It's essentially the same as far as the way it works and goes up. All right, buckle up, because I'm going to go through all of the tips and tricks that I have from decades of doing this to make this stuff last. The number one thing is to back prime your siding. So the back side of your siding needs to have at least one coat of paint, and even two is better. The reason that's important is that there's a certain amount of moisture that migrates from the inside of a house to the outside in certain times of year, and that moisture is going to go through the siding. If you have paint on one side and, you know, just a bare wood on the other side, that's an uneven situation where moisture can enter from one side, the back side in this case, and when it reaches the other side here, which is painted, that's going to start to bubble and peel that paint, and that's a problem, of course. So if you've painted the backside, that offers some protection from that moisture. It will still migrate out slowly, but it isn't going to just enter the backside and immediately try to get through the front side, and that's what takes the paint off. So that's a very common problem, and it's probably the number one thing. Now, I want to mention something that when you buy, in this case, this is a factory prime, right? When you see this gray priming here, that's all well and good, but when I have this situation, I still put another coat of paint over the factory prime. In other words, I don't believe the factory prime is enough. All right, tip number two, which is the front and which is the back? You'll notice when you buy cedar or redwood clapboard siding that there's a smooth side and there's a rough side. Probably most often the rough side goes to the back, and that is really more for aesthetic reasons. And traditionally, the smooth side, especially historic houses, the smooth side tends to go out. However, if the style will allow, it's actually better to put the rough side out. That's because the rough surface of this will hold the paint better than the smooth side. So if you have a choice, I would put the rough side out, and that will hold the paint better. All right, tip number three, while we're talking about paint, when you make a cut like this, that exposes the bare wood. You need to prime that before you put that up. So there's a couple ways you can do this. One is you could just keep a paintbrush and some paint on hand, so when you make a cut, you just dab this with a paintbrush, and that's enough to soak in and keep that protected. Another way of doing it is to keep a spray can of paint on hand. So when you make a cut, you just make a quick spray and you're done. But either way, you need to prime this bare wood after you make a cut. All right, the next tip, I'm already losing count. What do you use over the sheathing before you start siding? You need something to protect the sheathing and to keep the as an air barrier. So in the modern world, Tyvek might be one choice, right? And a lot of people have used this. However, there is a known interaction between Tyvek and cedar. The tannins in cedar interact with this Tyvek, and in pretty short order, like in the period of 4 or 5 years, the back of the cedar siding can rot out. Now, if the back is primed, back primed, like we talked about, that will help. However, it can still go through that. And I have personally seen this where entire sections of wall have been rotted because the people who installed it used Tyvek. So I don't use Tyvek at all when I'm putting up cedar, clapboard, or redwood even, clapboard siding. Instead, I go old school and use what's known as tar paper or felt. This is a 15-pound felt, which is okay, or you can use a 30-pound felt, which is thicker. And this has been used for, you know, probably a century underneath cedar clapboard siding, and it has no interaction. It'll work great. So that's what I use, and that wall that you saw earlier in the video, that's what I used underneath it, was tar paper. Having said that, there are certain areas where I don't feel that tar paper or felt is enough protection. Those include outside and inside corners. In those areas, I will often use a self-adhesive flashing like this. It doesn't have to be this brand, but something like it, just for an extra layer of protection, because that's an area where you do get a lot of water intrusion over time. So this will offer better protection than the tar paper or felt, whatever you want to call it. And that leads me to my next tip. When you have a seam right here between two boards, so this is the one row, then you'd have the next row, and you'd have two boards maybe where there's a seam. You need to protect that seam underneath with a piece of flashing. There's a number of different ways of doing this. Now, the old school way would be to cut strips of that tar paper we just talked about and slip them under this row, but over this row. And that's fine, but it doesn't last as long as some other options. Now, some people go crazy and they use aluminum flashing or copper flashing, which is also fine, but that can get pretty expensive and not as quick to install. So what I like to do now is, again, to use this self-adhesive flashing. So we'll install this strip of flashing, and because it is self-adhesive, it'll stay in place over the row below, okay? And then the boards on top go over like that, and this one will go like that. And the point is, if this joint ever opens up, water cannot get behind the row below, and that would rot it out. Instead, water would necessarily go over this bottom board here and come out to the open air, and that would be fine. Now, when I do the final painting, I will also often caulk this joint so that there's any gap in there, it's nicely sealed. But some people don't caulk that, and that's also fine. As long as you have this flashing behind it, you're good. All right, we need to talk about nailing now. There are two types of nails that you might use. On the right of your screen there is a oval head, or button head it's sometimes called, and that is a galvanized nail. You often see this on older houses, so if you're doing some patchwork, you may need to use this. It works pretty well. They are not the easiest to nail because the rounded head tends to give you trouble. So for people who are not experienced, you might have some trouble with this anyway. But it's an effective nail. However, over time, it will rust. So if it's not kept very well painted, you know, eventually the galvanization will wear off and you'll get some rust. This nail, by contrast, is stainless steel. Now, it has a more modern look to it, so if you're doing historical work, this may not be appropriate, but it is stainless steel, and it is going to last longer, and it's not ever going to rust. Now, we're going to be driving both of these nails by hand with a hammer. You don't want to see any power-driven nails in wood siding like this. The button head nail, it does look and work best if it's driven home just so that the wood fibers on the surface of the siding are just a little bit crushed. But the other nail, the stainless steel nail with a flat head, you're just going to drive it right to the surface and be done. Now, clapboard siding has what's known as an exposure. In other words, how much of the board shows. So this is a 6-inch cedar clapboard siding, which measures 5.5 inches, okay? Now, a typical exposure for that would be 4.5 inches. Now, it can vary. Sometimes it's 4 inches. Sometimes it's even as little as 3. But a typical exposure for this would be 4.5. That means that the board above it overlaps by 1 inch, or about that, okay? Once I know my exposure, that helps me determine where I'm gonna nail. So in this case, I have about a 1-inch overlap, and I'm gonna put my nail just above that. What I don't wanna do is trap the bottom board so that it doesn't have room to expand and contract with changes in season and humidity. So by putting it just above that, that gives me a little bit of room for this bottom board to expand and contract, and it will still hold the top board in place. The other thing I need to think about is how close to the edge I want to get. Now, not two is the answer. So I usually come in about 3/4 of an inch to an inch, depending on the situation. And when I have an end like this, I always pre-drill. Don't even think about not pre-drilling, because you're going to get a split in the end either immediately or later on as this moves. So pre-drill any ends and bring it in a little bit. When you're nailing in the center of the board, you usually do not need to pre-drill. However, there are certain cases where I will pre-drill the center of a board when, for example, the sheathing is not very flat and there's some, you know, gaps or spaces underneath. If you try to nail, you're going to end up cracking the siding. So in that case, I will pre-drill. So you have to keep your wits about you. But again, in the center of the board, I'm going to keep the nail above the bottom board so that it has room to move and expand and contract. And finally, when we're nailing, we want to try to find the studs. In other words, we want to nail into the studs. Admittedly, there are cases where, you know, that's just not possible. Maybe you can't physically get into a space or something like that. It does happen. But by and large, we want this nail to go into the stud. When you nail through the top of a piece of siding, this is what tends to happen. It's very thin, it's pretty fragile, and just the nail itself is enough to split it apart. Now, when we have siding coming up to a piece of trim, it might be a door, a window, or something else, it's very common just to butt the two together. There are other ways of doing it, but this is a very common way, and that's fine. We're going to caulk that later. However, there are two things we need to do now. One is we want to make sure we have flashing underneath the piece of trim and underneath the siding so that any water that gets into that seam has a place to go. We don't want it getting behind the siding and rotting the siding out or causing the paint to peel. The other thing we want to make sure is that the trim piece is taller or proud of the siding, so that we have a place here to put a nice bead of caulk. If we have these two at the same level, that's not going to provide a good place to caulk. Now, once the siding is nailed up, we need to do some prep before we do the final painting. Now, I showed this piece of bare wood here as an example of trim. However, I would not put trim up before it was primed. So one important thing to note here is that when you have siding butting up against a piece of trim, if you try to put up bare wood trim first, that area where the siding hits will not get primed if you try to prime it after. So I always prime the trim before I put it up. And then let's talk about the siding itself. Again, this is a factory prime, and in theory you can paint right over it. However, I don't trust the factory prime, especially because it tends to age before it ever gets put up. So it might be sitting in a lumber yard or a warehouse somewhere for quite some time before it ever gets to you. So when I have this up, I will prime it before I do the finish coat, even if there is a factory prime. That's a lot more work, yes, but it is important. And it's even more important if the siding you're using is finger jointed, which is pretty common now. I don't like it, but sometimes that's all I can buy. So in all cases, I try to prime this even if it has a factory prime before I start any finish painting. So after I've done the prime coat, then I'm going to do some caulking. Now, there is some controversy about this, but I'm going to tell you what I think is the correct way. When you have siding butting up against some kind of trim, this would be primed again, then in New England especially, I see this, some people will put just a bead of caulk with the caulk gun and leave it. I don't think that's adequate, and I also think it looks poor. So what I do is I put the bead of caulk, and then I will bed that caulk either using my finger or a rag or a tool, whatever you want to do, but something to push that caulk into any gap there and seal it. So I want to see the caulk adhered to this side and adhered to this side. And if you just use the caulk gun and leave that round bead there, that's not enough in my opinion. So I bed that caulk with my finger and make sure it's smooth and looks good. As I said earlier, you can choose to caulk the seam here if you want. Sometimes I do, sometimes I don't. I kind of look at the situation. But as long as you have the flashing underneath, then that water will not get behind the board below and it will be okay. So if the flashing is the important thing, the caulking is a matter of opinion. And then it's time for the finish coats of paint. And this is really important. It's probably the second most important thing. Remember, the first important thing I told you was back priming. And the second is this. You have to use a paint brush. I see all sorts of painting contractors using sprayers. Sometimes they'll spray it on and brush over. Sometimes they'll roll it on. Sometimes they'll roll it on and brush over. But I don't believe that's adequate. In my opinion, a paintbrush for the entire job, and I'm talking two coats of finish paint, is necessary for a long-lasting job. The jobs that I see that don't last long are the ones that are rolled on or sprayed on, and it just doesn't have as good adhesion because you're not working it in as you're going. Now, the paint formulations have changed over the years, and it can be very difficult, quite honestly, to keep a wet edge as you go. You can choose to paint in the shade and then work around with the sun and do the best you can, but it is a problem now because the paints dry so quickly in the modern world that it's just tough to keep that wet edge. However, I still use a paintbrush, and that works the paint into all the crevices and crannies, especially if you have the rough side out. It's just a better job. So if you want the paint job to last, use a paintbrush. Now, if you're meticulous about all these tips and tricks that I've been talking about, you can easily get 10 years out of a paint job, even with a southern exposure. And in some cases, you might get as much as 20 years out of a paint job. That said, be prepared to do some touch-up on trim, because trim does take more of a beating, especially if you have trim like a water table or something like that, which has a horizontal aspect to it, and that takes more of a beating. But if you just touch up the trim, the siding itself can easily get 10 years. Now, if you have a special concern or question, please leave a comment. I would love to see it. I'm very passionate about wood siding. I think it kind of got a bad rap because people weren't installing it very well. But if it's installed correctly, you can get a lot of life out of this.